So how many people are moving from our surrealist
return, but the life of man is short as dust in wheat. Good evening. Echo Ho playing her slow quin or slow chin. I hear that there are different pronunciations for this instrument. Wonderful that you are here tonight with us. A beautiful instrument, hybrid in time. It comes from deep time in the past and goes through the electronic presence which Echo has treated into the instrument into the future. Echo Ho is a true time-based artist, if I may say so, a TTA, a filmmaker, a composer, a sound researcher, Klangforscherin, musician, archaeologist, experimental artist. With her slow quin, she is not only reinterpreting the past presence are transformed into a possibility space of a special kind. I hope this is okay for you, Echo. I call this prospective archaeology. A musical instrument as a time machine. We shall hear more about it during the evening. Thanks a lot, Echo, for coming. Welcome to Potential Spaces. For our university, this is a very special conference. The University of Arts and Design, Karlsruhe, was founded as a new kind of an art school 25 years ago. A quarter of a century is not much for an academic institution. In fact, we are still beginning. There is hopefully more future to come than there is past behind us. This is the advantage when you are young. So, celebrating the first 25 years, we look forward. This includes the occasional retrospective view. We invited friends and colleagues from different parts of the world to discuss the future of the field. We are all passionate working for the arts, design, and critical thought about the different aesthetic practices. At the beginning, it's my great pleasure to introduce Johnson Chang from Hong Kong, who just arrived a few hours ago and will give some introductory words. Usually somebody very official is speaking at the beginning of a conference. It's a great pleasure that Johnson Chang takes this role tonight. Many of you know him as the founder and famous director of Han Art TZ Gallery in Hong Kong, and curator, project organizer, the perhaps one of the most important protagonists for establishing what can be called contemporary Chinese art scene. Amongst many other activities, he is also guest professor at the China Academy of Art in Hangzhou, and for our context, also very interesting and important, he is board member of the Asia Art Archive. I'm sure that Johann Hartle will introduce him tomorrow more detailed. Tonight, we have not so much time. Johnson, I would like you to come to the stage and speak to us. For myself, if I may add this personally, when I met Johnson Chang for the first time in Hong Kong, it was a wonderful experience. For me, he is the most wonderful protagonist of an economy of friendship and hospitality. I'm very grateful that he will open now our conference with his introductory remarks. Johnson, please come to the stage.
Siegfried and friends here, thank you very much for your very kind words and overly kind. I'm absolutely terrified now. In fact, I'm most honored to be invited to make a speech ahead of so many illustrious scholars here, especially Professor Hans Belting, who we are honoring with this conference. So I just wish to share a few ideas about potential spaces which are derived from the complex landscape of contemporary art education in China. To start with, a first seminar event can be identified in the year 1905. In 1905, during what was to be the last decade of dynastic China, an extreme reform of the imperial examination syllabus for civil servants was introduced. Confucian classics were abolished, giving way to a syllabus of technical and scientific learning imported from Europe. This institutional move marked a radical shift in the traditional knowledge system, a turn that heralded a change tantamount to no less than an abandonment of China's cultural and cosmological systems. After the Republican Revolution of 1911, the reform of the educational system continued apace to accompany the modernization of the political system. So, in 1922, a new national education system based on the American model was officially instituted. From that year, the foundation for China's civilizational transformation, a change in its episteme, was complete. It marks the most radical epistemic change since the arrival of Buddhistic knowledge 2,000 years before. Now, China is just one example of the radical cultural transformation that became nearly universal across the non-Western world in the past century. Even though there have been mobilization and struggles against Western imperialism and capitalist colonialism, but cultural transformations have invariably been pursued willingly from within, and almost always beginning on the basis of seeking new technology and new knowledge. But it is starting from here that old political institutions and indigenous cultural edifices begin to crumble. The modern classification of knowledge was, of course, perfected here on German soil and went global in the 19th century. Today, global issues arising in the wake of the internet revolution and the spread of neoliberal capitalism present unprecedented challenges to the universal paradigm founded by the West. But when we look to the non-West for fresh resources, one finds the loss of indigenous knowledge has been so thorough that most modernized non-Western societies have already turned into versions of the West. The post-colonial turn, for example, represented by the proposal to provincialize Europe, has provided a narrative of power structure, but solutions for assessing indigenous pre-modern knowledge have been sporadic. There are no competing paradigmatic models because the episteme that legitimize and makes sense of current knowledge in modernized non-West is, in fact, Western. So the pertinent question for the non-Western world, therefore, appears to be, how do we locate and recover pre-modern knowledge from within the all-encompassing modern schema? It is only by answering this question that the next question can be asked, how to extricate oneself from the state of colonization that is more fundamental than imperialism or capitalist exploitation, but arising from epistemic transformation. How might the non-West truly contribute to global knowledge? I wish to cite an example of a project developed at the China Academy of Art that attempts to reinterpret modern China in the form of a coherent historical narrative. This is a project created together with Professor Gao Shiming and Johann Hartl. Both took part in this project a few years ago. Art as the most sensitive barometer for telling shifts in aesthetics and therefore ideological turns reveals its nature in the art institution. In China, one finds that there are three separate art worlds that cohabit the same institution. Of these three parallel art worlds, two are modern constructs: the global capitalist art world that we all are familiar with, and the socialist art world that bear the legacy of communist China. And the third art world is that of the traditional literati scholar, which comes from a continuous narrative of fine art that stretches across two millennia. China's three art worlds may legitimately be called worlds because each claims its own independent ideological system and cultural practices. The art from the three worlds serve different purposes in society, and artists are rewarded and educated differently. But the important point is that these three structures still exist even today, institutionally and simultaneously. Seeing how aesthetic sensibility is instituted allows one to ask about the particular culture of the people. In the case of China, having three separate institutional constructs makes it possible to analyze how a specific artwork or particular cultural practice is affected by other parallel practices. Take, for example, the exhibition space. The modern contemporary art museum is predominant only in the global capitalist world, while the traditional literati art world never produced or embraced public exhibitions. Therefore, by examining the traditional literati site of display, which is the classical scholar's garden, a private space, indigenous aesthetics, pre-modern cosmology may be studied and brought into play with contemporary realities. Aesthetics, and therefore ideology, in pre-modern China were not principally kept within the precinct of fine art. The aesthetics of the people were institutionalized in rites and rituals. As an initial step to recover this dimension of aesthetics, Tsinghua University, the School of Creative Media of Hong Kong City University, the China Academy of Art, joined forces with the nonprofit institution Jiali Hall to reenact rites recorded and edited by Confucius in the 5th century BC. In these rites, one may see how aesthetic practice is cultivated as a technique of the body, and as a technique of the social body, rites and rituals also function as a politics of the body. As a politics, rites and rituals offer a tool for negotiation and freedom, as well as opening up a space for playing. What the latter example also illustrates is a strategy for recovering knowledge from classical learning. For 1,300 years, the civil service of China was based on an examination and education system that underscored the so-called five classics of learning. These classics underpinned the cosmology and were the basis of cultural practice of pre-modern China. In order to recover the contemporary relevance, the curatorial strategy adopted here is to revisit them as historical tool books, as manuals for particular techniques that made China's cosmology work, which means how it would function as a polity and a civilization. What is being proposed by the examples above point a way for stepping beyond the constraints of the post-colonial. For illuminating the conditions of the colonial power structure, post-colonialism is of fundamental importance. But as a practice, it is also handicapped by its methodology, in that it stares its adversary too closely in the eye. By focusing on the colonial, it gets trapped by topical concerns and game rules that are set by the dominant adversary and becomes gradually cornered into the position of identity politics. To return to the topic of the day, as regards non-Western cultures, the most important consideration is to recover alternative knowledge systems, to seek ways to revisit and make relevant one's own historical resources in order to contribute to the global order, and to take part in seeking a politics of the future that is truly open and multifarious. I look forward very much to the next 2 days, and thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Johnson. I'm sure that many of the subjects you have addressed already will be picked up during the conference and even perhaps tonight already after we have a discussion with Hans Belting after his speech. It's a great pleasure for me now to introduce Peter Weibel, our great friend and neighbor, the director of the ZKM. Most of you know him. Peter Weibel, artist, thinker, writer, and for all of us, a generator of surprises who never gets tired. Head and inventor and energetic heart of what is worldwide known as the ZKM, one of the most innovative and influential exhibition machines and research laboratories. Others are just showing art. Peter is presenting research projects, investigations into the task, how to change the world. He shows thought images. Peter Weibel, as many of you know, is not only an artist, thinker, director of the ZKM, and so on and so on. He has also taught in many countries. In fact, he is the only one from whom I know that he had 3 professorships parallel at the same time. The universities did not know that he had the other one. So he was paid by 3 universities at the same time in Canada, in Germany, and in Austria, many years ago, of course. He's a founder of various institutes, departments for investigation of the arts, sciences, and technologies in Buffalo, in Vienna, in Frankfurt, and at various other places. I'm very happy to work here with him and to be privileged to develop with him for the next years, hopefully, a postgraduate course on art and technology. Please welcome Peter Weibel.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear Siegfried, thank you for your 2 kind words. Therefore, I now feel like Sean Son Chang. I feel terrified too, like you. Potential spaces, let me speak, I will make some remarks on the potential space of knowledge. That means the potential of knowledge, as it was mentioned, knowledge space is a decorum. As we know, the spaces of art are known to be full of potentials, which mean, in fact, they are rich of the potentials of people, people who don't stop learning, who are inquisitive and eager to learn and eager to teach. And one of the answers to these questions, why do people learn, why do people want to acquire knowledge, is that they say, okay, people are motivated. And normally people think the word motivation is a psychological word. But in fact, here already starts the trouble. Because motivation is a word developed in 19th century psychology, derived from machines. Because motivation comes from motivus, in motion, like a machine. So therefore, when we speak about people who are motivated to learn, we already have in mind an idea that the psychic apparatus, another model of machine for the human mind, is so we have already when we speak about learning and potential and teaching, we have in mind already something, a kind of machine model of the mind, even when we think it's wonderful to speak about motivated people. So my question will be today, how can an academy, a university, empower knowledge? Normally, it is easier to say an academy, a university, is a place of learning, a teaching, in short, to acquire or to teach knowledge. But what kind of knowledge is it? Knowledge of what? And is a university, could it be a place of unified knowledge or a knowledge of the universe in total? These are important questions because today we face, in fact, a crisis of learning. For example, as you have learned, and Siegfried will speak about, I hope, later again or tomorrow, the crisis of knowledge is answered in Finland, for example, that in Finland, Finland will get rid of all school subjects. Even when the education system in Finland is known as one of the best, they will really make a revolution in the school system because they will change, they will have no subjects anymore from the curriculum. They will not teach any longer mathematics, physics, literature, history, geography. No. Instead of individual subjects and themes, they will study events and phenomena. They are in favor of an interdisciplinary format. On the other side, we have a crisis of learning in Germany. There's a tremendous decline of the knowledge of students and pupils in schools. One answer was always because of migration. Now they've taken a closer look and discovered that people, students and pupils who have no migration background also decline strongly in effects of learning. Therefore, we have to ask ourselves, when we want to acquire knowledge, when we want to empower knowledge, do we have still the right tools? The classical tools of learning is naturally language. And for example, one of the most famous books written 1690 by John Locke had the title, An Essay Concerning Human Understanding. A very strange title, in fact, from perspective today. It comes from Cicero, from his book De Natura Deorum, The Nature of Gods. And here you already see the idea. There's a decline of knowledge from God to human, and this is what I want to speak about in some minutes, a decline from God to human and to machines. Or is it not a decline? Maybe the knowledge of the gods was not as big. Maybe the knowledge of human people is not as big as we think. Maybe the knowledge of algorithms and machines and other ambient systems will help us to understand the human nature better than if we do it now. The first idea in this direction was written down by the encyclopedists. In this famous Dictionnaire raisonné, des sciences, des arts et des métiers, published in 17 volumes at the end of 18th century, they have been looking for unified science. They have been looking for an interdisciplinary way. And the emphasis in this book was not on language. The emphasis in this book was on crafts and technical tools and machines. The Nobel Prize winner of economics, Mr. Daniel Kahneman, wrote a book called Thinking Fast and Slow. And he said we have two models. System one is fast thinking, which is emotional and instinctive. System two is slower thinking, which is more logical and deliberative. And at the end of the book, he says, after decades of academic research, he has learned that people place too much confidence in human judgment. This is a strong provocation after Kant, after all these idealist ideas of human understanding from Hume to Kant, and human knowledge and human ratio. Therefore, we have to write today a new essay concerning machine understanding. In a double sense, first, how do machines learn? How do machines understand? And second, how do we understand machines? There's a new situation. When you drive in a car, this is a kind of model for motivation, then the first time you realize between you, the subject, and the environment, to learn how to behave in the environment, you have an interface which is a car. And you know precisely that the car tells you sometimes you should drop off from the autobahn because there's some problems, etc. So you see now, the machine knows more than you. You still have the decision, you follow the route, which you think is the better one, or you follow the recommendation of the navigation system. And most people, in fact, follow not the proposition of, for example, the husband or the wife, they follow the navigation system. So you see, we are already here to accept the situation that machine learning can help us to understand better our environment. To make it more general, machine learning is just one part of ambient-assisted learning. This is my goal, ambient-assisted learning. And therefore, it's cool already here. We have Mr. Pasquinelli teaching artificial intelligence. This is a very important step forward. And next year, ZCAM will open a new laboratory called Herz Laboratory together with the HFG. And we also in this laboratory, we want to study how machine learning compared to human learning may function. And to tell you another example about the situation, which is really provocating, we have concerts already now by robots on the stage. And in the audience are people. Human people are listening to the music of robots. This is accepted. Therefore, we can imagine the next step will be human people play on the stage and the audience is robots. So it's just the opposite. And from this model, from art, we can learn at the moment humans educate robots. But the next step will be that robots educate humans. So that machine learning helps us to understand human learning. That machine intelligence will help us to understand human intelligence. But as I said before, you should not think too narrow. Machine is just a part of the environment, of the system, the ambience around you. So what we are looking forward is ambient-assisted learning, ambient-assisted understanding. But despite my prognosis, I'm still very happy to be here and to learn something from human to human. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much again, Echo. We will have the great pleasure to listen to her at the end of our program tonight. Now I'm getting nervous because I'm close to introduce Hans Belting. Potential spaces, possibility spaces, Möglichkeitsräume, if I'm allowed to use this German term, which I like a lot. How can art and design be thought, researched, and taught in the future? By the way, what you see here is a drawing by Namjoon Paik. It contains, in a minimalistic gesture, the most important terms we are discussing, feedback and feed forth, and the vertical, Daniel Irgang helped me, stands for now and infinity. The fields within which we act and think have changed tremendously, politically, economically, technologically. Colleagues from very different regions and intellectual perspectives will discuss with us during the next days where things might go and how we can interfere into their movements. Peter Weibel was talking about this important concept. We hopefully have been successful in bringing together a heterogeneous and transdisciplinary group of thinkers and artists. But right at the beginning, we shall focus on the most important subject that is connecting us all, the aesthetic praxis that we call the arts. What do we refer to when we are talking about the arts today in the different parts of the world? How can we conceptualize it for the coming decades beyond simple market mechanisms and strategies, which all of us are not really interested in? And most important, the question, can we still distinguish a special sphere that we can call the arts? Or is everything aesthetical, dissolving in a kind of poetics of relation and a kind of praise of superficialities? Nobody else could help us better to ask such big questions than Hans Belting. To introduce him here in this building, in this house, is a little bizarre. Hans Belting was a co-founder of this university, which we call now our home, when he took over the chair for art studies and media theory in 1992. For 10 years, he shaped the HFG, the University of Arts and Design, as a new art university after he had left the more conservative Institute for Art History at the University of Munich. After a short excursion to Vienna as director of the Institute for Cultural Studies, Hans Belting came back to Karlsruhe to build up the research project which most of you know very well, GAM, GAM, Global Art and the Museum, together with Andrea Buddensieg, whom you will learn to know tomorrow, and of course, Peter Weibel. We will come back to this wonderful project definitely during our conference. What I admire so much in Hans Belting's academic and intellectual career is that he did not sit out his chair, as so many colleagues are doing, but again and again reinvented himself, provoked and transgressed his discipline. From the classical art history to an anthropologically based Bildwissenschaften, towards an expanded art theory, which self-evidently is including media theory, towards a mondial understanding of art praxis and art theory. The many, many, many publications generated by him and, for example, the GAM project show especially the latter impressively, as well as his thought-provoking book, Florence and Baghdad, Renaissance Art and Arab Science. I don't know what you think, Hans. I like the German subtitle more than the English subtitle because it refers to the view as the active part of constructing an image in confrontation with what we can see outside of ourselves. This was a little bit different. Currently, Hans Belting is writing a book on Leopold Seda-Senghor together with Andreas Buddensieg, and Senghor's vision of another modernity. So the title of a lecture Hans Belting gave a while ago in Berlin. This is where he is located now, and again supports young researchers, young theoreticians, young thinkers in the Berlin case at the Free University in Dahlem. 2015, Hans Belting received one of the most prestigious and valuable awards in the academic world, the Balzan Award in Switzerland. Exactly 30 years before him, another art historian received this award. Hans Belting called him the prima donna assoluta of art history, a certain Sir E. H. Gombrich. Tonight, Hans Belting's lecture is titled Looking at Art History Today, a Critical Re-examination of E. H. Gombrich. Welcome, Hans Belting.
Dear Siegfried, now I am the third to be terrified today. But I would like to thank you so much, dear Siegfried, for inviting me back to my old school and to Karlsruhe. This is a wonderful feeling. When I first came to Karlsruhe, I came from Munich. Now I come from Berlin, where we live since half a year. I followed the school, I was linked with the school from early days on. And at that time, when I came here, the ZKM consisted of three persons. First, Heinrich Klotz. Second, the beautiful Ingrid Truxer at his door. And third, Jeffrey Shaw, who has come back tonight and is with us. But the school was earlier opened than the ZKM, but not opened in Karlsruhe, as I thought at the time, but in a suburb, Grünwinkel, where the school had rented a building by a brewery with a huge M above the roof. So newcomers thought this was media school. In fact, it was the logo of the brewery with the name Moninger. But the ZKM was first to move into this building. And the school came then. And now this is symbolical, a unit between two institutions which were founded at the same time. The first years were very tough because we had nothing at our disposal, but were exciting. And I'm very pleased to have the feeling that there is new excitement coming back and that the school is now founded again, which is, of course, what is such a promoter, a future-oriented invitation must do. Now I have something to talk and something of which must sound very old-fashioned, but what do you expect from me? I feel protected by the logo, which you see from Nam June Paik. And I will just tell you one story. When he became 70, Nam June Paik, I sent him a fax stating that when you today wake up, I will already have given a talk on you. Because he lived in New York, and so there was a 6 hours difference. The answer came back, just a drawing. A Buddha drawing. What could one say more? When I was asked to contribute to a conference about potential spaces in today's writing on art, I decided for art history Western type, because, as you will see, it offers new potentialities when read against its grain, or the grain. I hope to counteract its reputation when, as a single package that has done its service once and forever. On closer inspection, it reveals a rich array of methods that wait to be reapplied by newcomers from other cultures, once it serves as a fresh starting point. Like all other humanities, including philosophy, art history was centered on its own space and therefore studied the history of that space. The space of European culture was a given. Even Abi Warburg remained in this tradition when he spoke of the Nachleben survival of antiquity in Western imagery. Hegel is but one example when he denied the existence of history beyond the pale of Western culture, as Arthur Danto has repeatedly shown. When we redirect the vertical axis or the axis of time between past and future that provided the yardstick of Western thought, and when we introduce the horizontal axis in crossing the border to other spaces and cultures that coexist with us, art history provides the necessary tools. These other spaces had been left to ethnography, whose field was directed to bygone cultures with another time. If we, however, start again, we discover in art history much that does not need to be invented again. My book, The End of the History of Art, was understood in China as an invitation to share the game. In what follows, I invite you to revisit the work of Ernst H. Gombrich, whose book, The Story of Art, from 1950, went around the world and has today received 16 editions. Just a brief introduction to whom we are talking. Gombrich was born in 1909 into a Jewish family in Vienna and studied with Julius von Schlosser. He was closely linked with Ernst Chris, who had a second training as psychoanalyst and belonged to the closer circle of Sigmund Freud. In 1934, Chris and Otto Kunz published the famous book Die Legende vom Künstler, The Legend of the Artist. His closest friend, however, was and remained the philosopher Karl Popper, who in the same year, 1934, published his first book. Soon, Popper, Gombrich, and others had to leave Austria and published further on in English. In London, Gombrich eventually became professor of the history of the classic tradition. What a wonderful title. One has to enjoy it. It gives an interesting side of what is possible in England. And he acted as director of the Warburg Library, which was exiled from Hamburg. In 1970, he published his first biography of Abi Warburg, which caused a vivid discussion because of its critical stance on what he called the Warburg myth. In his late years, Gombrich received many honors and prizes. He was knighted by the Queen. In the following, I would like to address two of his publications. In the first, the book Art and Illusion, and secondly, the book The Sense of Order. My presentation is divided into three parts. The first part I would like to call Perception and Representation. The second, Decoration or Demonstration, I will leave out for lack of time, And the third part will be overscribed as art after the end of art. Now let's begin with one of the two books. Ernst Gombrich's book, Art and Illusion, has influenced an entire generation. It appeared in 1960 and is based on the Mellon Lectures, which Gombrich delivered in Washington in 1956. I remember to have read it with awe and admiration. I believed every sentence. It is a brilliant achievement. And if I have today objections, it is about two premises, which I did not question at the time. Firstly, that art is by definition Western art, with premises in the Greek world. And secondly, that art and visual culture are one and the same thing. There is an inherent contradiction in describing a given visual culture in total as art. But on the other hand, using a local art production, such as Western art, for a universally and everywhere valid concept of art. Let me summarize first his book. In order to relate picture making and picture seeing, the author draws on psychology. His psychology of representation, of pictorial representation, as the subtitle reads, relates specific patterns of representation with those of perception. Accordingly, modifications or modalities of representation connect us with perception in a process of making and matching. So it's not the question whether art represents the real, it represents how it does it so, and what formalities and modes and formulas it uses to offer representation. For Gombrich, this was the very riddle of style. The history of art was for him not a history of evolution, but a process of trial and error, which obviously follows a model from the sciences. Art is mimetic in its relation to nature, and thus meets the needs and expectations of a period. Expectation creates illusion, and knowledge fills gaps. Changes happen when familiar patterns of representation are tested against nature or against new discoveries. Illusion is created by mimetic art that identifies representation with what it represented, the so-called real. The author knows the distinction between conceptual and perceptual art, but he declares all art to be conceptual in that it relies on traditional schemata or models rather than on direct perception of nature. In his review of the book, Rudolf Arnheim objects that Gombrich simplified the notion and the use of art in his mimetic concerns. But Gombrich would have answered that art used concepts in order to match what the artist saw. And therefore, I quote him, all representations are recognizable by their style. When reading the book today, I have my doubts about an art history based entirely on psychology. The universal authority of one type of psychology for perception is easily disproved when examined in a transcultural view. Even the art concept is a cultural construction to which we will come back. I also have reservations about the preference of the timeline when Gombrich discusses the sequence of schemata of representation as improvement in art. It is a space that distinguishes the role of representation from one culture to the other. Pictorial perspective, the heritage of Florence, is a good example for a critical stance when its universal claims are examined. As a Western code of representation, it has defied exportation for a considerable time. Already the Jesuit missionaries provoked resistance among cultures such as China, where perception was subject to another condition. If one accepts perspective as culture-specific, it is clear why no equivalent has ever been found in any other culture. When we understand that perspective was grounded in an Arab theory of perception, as I have proposed, it has become abundantly clear that its application in picture making was a product of Western culture. The transformation of an aniconic perception theory from the Middle East, Ibn al-Haytham and his treatise translated under the title Perspective. So strangely enough, the first book with the title Perspective was an Arab treatise in the West. Into a pictorial practice of the West illuminates the difference between two visual cultures, which in their picture making are distinct from one another as social practices of the gaze. Arab science only admits the image as a mental affair and not as a material item. The Arab scientists located images in the brain, while the Renaissance erroneously located it in the eye. In a history of the gaze, which was the topic of my lectures at the Collège de France, a history of gaze was the topic. I described perspective as a cultural technique in which a society held up a mirror to itself. It was a quantum leap when the Renaissance introduced the gaze into the picture, thus making the spectator representable. Mathematical perspective has been a favorite theme since Erwin Panofsky. In referring to it as a symbolic form, the author did, however, not answer the question as to what makes a form symbolic in a given culture. It cannot be doubted that perspective was a construction when taking the gaze as yardstick. Because in perception, our gaze wanders about. Perspective constructed a firm viewing point. As however, the gaze is not a geometric quantity, but originates in a body with two eyes. Perspective resolved the conflict by fixing the eye to a vanishing point, which represents the viewer. To quote from the mathematician Brian Rotman, the vanishing point functions as a visual zero. Zero is one of the algebraic numbers, but functions different from any other number. The vanishing point represents the viewer, since only when nothing exists, vanishing point, but where something could exist, is the observer possible. The pictures always serve the gaze, but this does not mean that they also represent it. Also, Gombrich knew that a history of the gaze is not the same as a history of perception. It is with the same eyes that humans perceive the world. And yet, a gaze is above all a social act, and as such, I maintain, culture-specific. In every society, the gaze follows a collective praxis, even though we experience it as our own. Just as one may recognize people of different races by their body language, so one could recognize them by the way of representing the gaze. In this respect, the fetishism of the gaze has become specific for Western culture, at least between the 16th and 19th century. After that, photography took over the task of mimetic art. Gaze and eye are reciprocally entangled with one another. And it is not only gender discourse which has taught us about this relation. It is easy to understand why Gombrich decided against the attention to different cultures of the gaze, since this aimed at the unilateral narrative. Since this made difficult a unilateral narrative of art history. So here it is not what he should have done or what he did not, but to explain what his reasoning is my point today. For instance, I give you one example. In Muslim culture, the taboo of pictures points against the fetishism of the gaze. The veil, today is a symbol of oppression of women, was traditionally part of a strictly stratified culture of the gaze, which also marked the boundary between the private and the public sphere. Whereas women hide it behind veils, men were expected to avert their eyes. Figuration in art was suspected to invite the intrusive gaze, much as in the exchange of living glances. The Islamic interdiction of pictures that seem to be alive follows the interdiction of the gaze. In a text on the averted gaze, Hamid Nafisi compares the veil to walls and words. I quote, "Walls, words, and veils mark, mask, and separate both women and men." The male partner was obliged to announce his visit by his voice and to employ formal language. In this culture, the gaze controlled that of others in equal measure as it was itself controlled by these others. According to Nafisi, the Persian bookmakers divided the space in separate layers, accessible only one after the other, to avoid the dominance of one viewer. Now, I would have presented you the second part, which for me was the main item of my work in the last weeks. But this would a little bit lead you away from our main road. I call decoration or demonstration the ornament. Because here again, Gombrich assumes a global perception of the ornament which he originally wanted to call unregarded art, because, as he writes, ornament does not impart information and therefore rarely invites conscious scrutiny. It serves fluctuating attention. Now here again, we meet the same author. He offers us a universal theory of ornament, geometry, around the world, but he is not even mentioning the possibility that ornaments follow very different traditions according to the culture which apply ornaments. So I leave this part out and come to the third part, the last part, which I will call art after the end of art. When we now return to Gombrich's book Art and Illusion, it tells us that Western art was a permanent experiment to attract the gaze with ever new surprises. Even forged gazes were looking back to us from the picture. Art turned the viewer into a voyeur, whose gaze was quite literally captivated by subjects such as the naked female body. The career of panel painting once had begun in the Renaissance with the metaphor of window and mirror. The viewers of pictures were offered an experience like the one behind a window or before a mirror, with which they were familiar already. The royal spectacle of the Meninas, which Velázquez painted at the Spanish court, over the hierarchy of gazes looking at us, from the royal couple in the mirror to the little daughter and the bystanders, as Michel Foucault has first demonstrated in a brilliant study in his book on representation. In modern times, the game of illusion did not go on with painting, but changed medium and penetrated ever new media, up to the data helmet and the selfie. The digital screen carries on the game of the framed and centralized viewing point. Today, we live no longer in a history of art, but in a history of media, which continue to produce the expected illusion that Gombrich identified in European art. Now we suddenly understand why modern art is conspicuously missing in Gombrich's book. In fact, art changed road as soon as it was freed from the old burden of representation, like the one Gombrich understood. With photography, film, and other media, illusion became the result of ever new techniques to do the job that once was reserved to the artist. Art, on the contrary, opted for a critique of representation. Surrealism and abstraction, to name only these, opened a never-seen realm of imagination beyond the real world. More importantly, avant-garde artists turned to art from other cultures to seek inspiration. While the West exported technology to many parts of the world, artists in the West imported models from the outside. They believed Western art to have lost the power of innovation from within. Thus, Western art thus does not resemble the fortress, as it is often understood. Gauguin was the first to go to the South Pacific in exile. Van Gogh deconstructed the viewing field of academic art with the help of Japanese woodcuts. The French avant-garde turned to so-called primitive art for revolutionizing art. The Munich exhibition, Masterpieces of Islamic Art in 1910, attracted visitors like Paul Klee and Henri Matisse, who shortly thereafter traveled to North Africa. After World War II, Mark Toby and the so-called Informel regarded the influence of the calligraphic from China as a great liberation from their own constraints. Here they suddenly are, potential spaces for shaking the foundations of Western art. Illusion of the real became obsolete. Art theory followed much later. Norman Bryson's essay on the gaze in the expanded field in the Far East from 1989 questioned the Western privilege of the looking subject, both in philosophy and in art. François Julien, the French philosopher, opened the road to a comparative approach of the visual culture of China. The Chinese art critic Li Qiangting pointed out the paradox that while Chinese art introduced Western realism, Western art turned the wheel around and looked to China. When we now turn to the master narratives of modern art, which today only remain a memory, we make a twofold discovery. First, they were not written as a continuation of Western art, but as a radical break with Western art and its traditions, and as a separate subject, as if the two were not culture-specific at all. Secondly, these master narratives turned up rather late, when much of modern art already had happened. A turning point was the foundation of the Museum of Modern Art, the first museum of its kind at New York. Its director, Alfred H. Barr Jr., designed genealogical trees for the first survey exhibitions, of European modernism in the 1930s. The overseas myth of modernism was, if you like, an American appropriation. The leading authority as an art critic became Clement Greenberg. In post-war times, few European authors such as Werner Haftmann and Werner Hofmann followed. Only the first Documenta in 1955 had resisted American participation. Soon thereafter, America's leadership in art production and art writing was firmly established. So you see, you also have to see this when you speak of Western art and Western theory. In the genre of art writing, it became mandatory to write the history of modern art as a history of permanent progress. Avant-garde, originally a military term, meant an exploration ahead of art. Art was tantamount to a never-ending search for inventions, much as it was expected from economic growth. So probably this link is very important. But classical modernism, as it was soon to be called, had a limited lifespan. For a while, exhibition art, despite its permanent crisis in art theories, defended the presence of the artwork with ever new games, such as the so-called exit of the picture out of the frame. The gallery space was a site where questionable objects were turned into art. Yves Klein therefore opened an exhibition with an empty gallery space in 1958, which we all admired. It was a wonderful opening of a gallery, but the gallery was empty. In the 70s, Brian O'Doherty published a farewell to modernist formalism in his famous essays, Inside the White Cube, the Ideology of the Gallery Space. The master narrative of modern art faced a dead end, while new media, installation, and performance art took the field. I don't need to sketch out the late history of modernism or the history of late modernism in minimal luxus, happening, land art, ad povera, and so on. But I must point out that it was again in America that the crisis of modernism was hotly debated in books that today look like signposts along the road to the end of modernism. I very well remember the excitement when we discussed art and where art was at the moment, where it had been, where it would go. This was something which took us all busy. When Harald Rosenberg published his book, The De-Definition of Art, in 1972, and argued that art had lost any definition, the art world was divided in the Greenberg Party and the Rosenberg Party. In 1977, Susie Gablik published her attack on the master narrative of the modern under the title Progress in Art. Her next book, with the title Has Modernism Failed, appeared in 1984. A few years earlier, in 1980, Doe Ashton, All Americans, whom I quote, in her book A Fable of Modern Art, described modernism on the basis of Balzac's famous artist novel as a myth. A curious melange of art criticism, post-histoire, and post-modernism centered on the existence or non-existence of a valid art concept. Conceptual art in the 1960s left no doubt that art was a mere concept that defied materialization. The break with formal modernism was complete. More importantly, conceptualism was simultaneously turning up in other parts of the world where the existence of modern art had been unfamiliar. An exhibition in the Queens Art Museum in New York in 1999, for the first time offered a survey of global conceptualism. The movement implied first a dematerialization of the art object. Second, an institutional critique of the art world. And finally, a linguistic orientation, as you all know. Lucy Lippert saw concept art emerge from two directions, art as idea and art as action. Art as action implied a more direct interaction with the social space than the art offered, the art object had ever offered. Thus, art lost its former basis and became a live operation with performance and audience participation. The caption for the third part of my presentation, Art After the End of Art, modifies a book title of my late friend Arthur Danto. When delivering the Mellon Lectures in 1995, almost 40 years after Gombrich's Mellon Lectures, Art and Illusion, Danto chose the title After the End of Art. After the End of Art is a double after end. This certainly was a new state of things that Gombrich could not have foreseen. It represents the position of a philosopher who, in front of Andy Warhol's Brillo boxes, had decided that philosophy was needed to speak on behalf of art after art was no longer self-explaining. My own version, when speaking of art after the end of art, has another scope. The fact that art continues and even experiences an unprecedented growth in the global age is without doubt. But I wonder whether art in the long run can be produced without a common concept of art, without acknowledging its history. Despite its endless modifications and contradictions, the art concept so far remains the result of its Western history and therefore is culture specific. Do we see today the end of its history, or will the arrival of global art open new and potential spaces for its definition, I ask? What will the art schools do today beyond providing technological skills and introduction to the economics of the art market? Art in late modernism still operated in the name and with the authority of art. Today, so-called projects seem not to need any longer art self-reference. They need artists rather than art. And may ask, what kind of narrative remains for telling the story of art and whether this is still possible? This question equally applies to Western art production, whose only remaining difference in the global age is its history. I will listen to the new participants of the game and hope to learn their answers to a question which in the global age we all have in common. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hans. We have now the possibility to discuss some of the questions you asked. I'm not very optimistic, but perhaps this is not our intention anyway, that we will find big answers on the big to the big questions. I would be very happy if we would carry on to ask the questions as intelligent as possible and as it's necessary. While the others are thinking what they would like to ask you, let me bridge the situation a little bit. Do I understand the concept of your thoughts of the last decades right? That at the end of very important questions you asked, there is always some kind of a plea of an openness, for an openness or for a multiplied view on the objects you were questioning. At the end of art history, you were pleading for different art histories from different points of view. At the end of Perspective, your book on Duchamp, on Sugimoto and Wall, you plea for a kind of opening up the classical perspective, the symbolic perspective, into some kind of a multi-point view. And at the end of the art, you are pleading for an opening in horizontal perspective and in vertical perspective. And you say goodbye to the concept of art, to the art, but not to art in general. Is that understood right?
Well, I don't know whether I understand it myself. Well, I argued in the first part that we must look for other spaces, since art history and the art discussion happened mostly inside the Western concept of a closed space. And I think the Western art discussion has produced its own end. Therefore, I gave the stops for over where it led to. And now I even began the global the GAM concept at ZKM with the curiosity, will other spaces introduce new concepts of art? Is this possible? And will we be open for them? So the timeline was the leading line in Western thought, because it always was centered on its own space, Gombrich and the other. And also in geometry, the same. I mean, Gombrich is for me, he is really the prima donna assoluta of my field, therefore I wanted to know it from him. But I think that Gombrich wrote, for instance, a short essay, In Search of Cultural History, 1969. So I opened it with great curiosity to find, what does he say about cultural history? And he speaks about the European space and whether art, music, literature, and poetry, and science can be all discussed under a nomen combinator of culture. That there exist other cultures came up not, and this has changed today. We are waiting, we are open, and as I said, my books in other parts of the world, Art History After Modernism, which exists even in Arab and Japanese, always had one offer. Please share the game. We are looking for you to come.
That's a wonderful perspective. Let me ask perhaps a little bit a provocative question, which goes back to our common friend Dietmar Kamper. I remember very well our discussions on art and illusion, and especially on Gombrich's views on illusion. And Dietmar Kamper said illusion comes from the Latin word illudere. And illudere does not only contain the der schöne Schein, the shining and the false shine, and all these connotations we know from everyday life, but it also contains the risk, to take a risk. Might this perhaps be something that we can still hope for? The artist and the work of art as something which takes a risk, which is able to do something very different than others who don't want to take the risk?
It itself is a pejorative term. It's close to delusion, illusion and delusion. Instead, illusion was never produced for the sole purpose of offering illusion, but for offering something which was attractive and which captivated the gaze. So I think what art is concerned, art is operating in a field beyond words often, in a poetical world, where of course new discoveries can first be formulated. This was of course one of the reasons of modern art originally, to start this way. And for me, the great seduction in philosophy are poets who do philosophy. Edouard Glissant is not analyzable to its details, but what he offers in language is something which inspires imagination. So I think imagination was the road which modern art followed after the mimetic purpose. In that, as I think, it was interesting for me to learn why Gombrich did not deal with modern art, because it did not follow the road of illusion, but took even the risk of representing a critique of representation. And therefore, we are speaking about very different periods and very different approaches. But what I wanted to, I just wanted to present you a question, because art after the end of art is really a question which is very important for me today, because I don't know the answer, but I wait for answers.
I think one of the reasons why we are gathering here is that this question is driving us all in a specific sense. There are wonderful brains in the audience. Please go ahead with asking questions to Hans Belting, Amador Vega, André Ucsika, Matthias Brun. He will be first. Matthias, please.
Yes, thank you very much for the talk and for giving me the opportunity to ask a question, an initial one perhaps. It is a footnote in a way, but I think it might be important. When Alfred Barr came to Berlin, he found a model for his Museum of Modern Art. Mm-hmm. It was the Galerie der Lebenden, the Gallery of the Living, when Ludwig Justi realized that after World War I, everything collapsed and there were empty spaces to fill. And he decided to make it a museum for living artists. Oh, no. And the fantastic thing is that he chose the title Gallery of the Living, while Alfred Barr turned it into Museum of Modern. And it's fantastic to see that this translation gave it a different tone, although the concept was the same. So it is about translation, sometimes wrong translation, but it's also about how the things develop when they're in the process of translation. So I find it very interesting that terms can change totally, and the concept, the innovation is the same. And what would be your idea about this? Let's say this process of that starts with this translation that Alfred Barr does.
Thank you very much. I did not know about this prehistory of the MoMA in New York. And Alfred Barr had seen this museum in Berlin. But when he had seen it, he did not act accordingly, because he excluded living artists from America in the first 10 years of the MoMA. Only the modernists from Europe were presentable. It went until a point where New York artists went on the street with protest signs, "We want to get into MoMA." 10 years later, it was the opposite. The Western were marginalized and the Americans were admitted. So I think one must also see these contradictions. But I think the living, that is something enormously interesting and difficult to pursue for many reasons. While the museum, once it is directed to the past, is no problem, but directed to the living, I understand that in the Middle East, they are now building in Abu Dhabi a museum of the future. This would be on top of the living.
Who else wants to comment? Peter?
Thank you for the inspiring lecture. And I want to learn slowly, therefore, logically. Hans, did you understand your argument correctly? Gombrich excluded in his history, in his book History of Art, modern art, because he wanted to say Western art, art is a Western concept. But he denied the fact that the inspiration of modern art was non-Western. I think it's a wonderful, very important argument to realize now after the end of modernism, 100 years, that in fact, the idea of modern art was relying on non-modern sources. Did I understand exactly? Huh? And therefore, in that sense, you mean this when you speak about the end of art, you mean this idea of art.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Very important statement. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, Peter, he included the Impressionists because they were still linked to an experiment to understand nature, to see the game of light. Also, the Pointillists were still following up this idea of the progressive and pattern and the models and so on. So he included these two, but then he cut off. The rest is missing. And this, I understood, is not because he didn't know it, but it was not part of his argument. It would not have been part of his argument.
Anybody else?
And the same happened with the sense of order. The sense of order is still more interesting. Because he, for instance, he says there are summits of ornamentation in the Far East, in the Middle East, in pre-Carolingian illumination and in late Gothic work. So what is it? He saw everything as expressions of one space and one tradition. In fact, they are representing different spaces. And this is a new, if we follow today a horizontal axis instead of the time axis, which limited us in our space, I think new possibilities are there.
I think to come back to your argument, it's really fundamental because after the Second World War, we all have been educated in the belief that modern art is the epistome, the culmination of Western ideas. But now we learn slowly that this is the opposite, that the basis of modern art was Japanism, tribalism, primitivism, etc., etc. So we have to learn that art is not a Western concept, that even modern art is based on non-Western sources. This is really shocking. But this is only what we learn through the work and the work of others the last decade, before we have all believing that the epitome of Western progressive thinking is modern art. And now we learn just the opposite, yeah.
Amador, behind you. Amador Vega from Barcelona.
Yeah, thank you, Hans. I have not answers for your big questions. I was just thinking about the difficult to think the relationships between in history, art, and time, no? Because as you know, there are cultures in Indian philosophy where history had no meanings, no? And then I was thinking about the possibility to have hope and in cultures without an eschatological conception of art. But the only thing I wanted to say is when you quote Michel de Foucault about Velázquez, because at this moment I thought that maybe in Spain, in Spanish culture, is the only culture where illusion is a positive concept. Maybe because we have this Quixote tradition from Cervantes, where illusion is not something negative. No? is maybe that has to do with our mystical tradition, no? Where fantasy and imagination are have two very different meanings. You know? But that was just a note and a comment. Thank you.
Thank you, Amador. But I would insist that illusion was not only positive in Spain. It was also the value system of perspective. By the way, Michel Foucault in this text makes a wonderful experiment, which I love, because he is maybe the only author which I ever found who is expecting that either he is right in language or the artwork is right. But he can never come to a basis where the visual world and the language world cover each other and are symmetrical. They are asymmetrical. So he comes to the end of his article in the argument that I hope to have proven that I'm wrong. And this is, of course, brilliant. I would also like to do it.
That's wonderful. Jeffrey Shaw, please.
Hans, I was very taken with this question, the question that we all ask, which is art after the end of art, because it's an impossible question. If there is art after the end of art, there is still art. If it's the end of art, there is no art after the end of art. But you have opened a door in this talk you've just given. You said, what is art after the end of art? You suggested that there are projects which need artists. And this is a very interesting question. What are these projects? And who are these artists that are needed to do these projects? I mean, this could be a door that opens at the end of art.
Thank you, Jeffrey. I'm afraid I was a little bit critical in my attitude to this question, because I sometimes miss art in our discussion of art projects. But I think if you attribute to project a more general sense, it's actually also art is a project which is never fulfilled, because it is never finishable. It goes beyond. And if I see your own work from the 90s to today, I see now on this beautiful video installation with Confucius that you are following very interesting aesthetic play, which have nothing to do with deception of the eye or the illusion of the real. And so it is, for me, I want to learn, because the only thing I wanted to say is some decades ago, in 1970, we were all hot with waiting what happens next in art. And this I sometimes miss today.
Nikos, from Australia, please give him the microphone.
Thank you. Maybe I'll try and continue from that last question. Because in the lecture you mentioned that with the emergence of the vanishing point arrives the observer. I think you said something to that effect. What happens then when the door has opened, art after the end of art, and the art becomes a project, an event, it goes outside, it becomes action? Or when it's inside and there is no vanishing point and there are multiple perspectives in immersive environments? So who has come in then in these environments? Or how would we call the person who's engaging with art outside of that space, in the space of action?
You are seducing me into an impossible situation, because a vanishing point can also be called symbolical. Where is the vanishing point of art, instead of where is the vanishing point of the observer? I think I like now the idea of the vanishing point beyond what I said. I know your own publications, they have centered on areas where not a single vanishing point is possible in the ambience, in the expanded ambience. And this, I think, is a question which also Norman Prison has dealt with. If we have an expanded field where not a single viewer is expected to participate, but where a different rule governs the game. And interestingly enough, Norman Prison describes his other aesthetics of the expanded field with a Far Eastern critic of the Western category of the subject, of the one centralized looking subject for which the whole world is part of his gaze. That is a beautiful difference, which I think opens new doors.
I'm absolutely convinced that this will play an important role in our discussions during the next days. The question of subjectivity and the connection between a traditional concept of art, a Western concept of art, and a specific concept of subjectivity. Again, you mentioned Edouard Clisson. He had this wonderful idea of a synthetic identity into which we more and more fade. This helps perhaps also to think art in a different way. It's definitely not the one solid and consistent art anymore we are used to in a specific Western tradition.
Absolutely. He had also the wonderful concept of the pelagus, the insular world, that the world consisting of islands where different subjects are living and different ideas of what a subject is and is not. So this opens also a door to many other spaces.
Wonderful. Just one more comment regarding also Jeffrey's question. There's one philosopher we can bring into the game here, Wilhelm Flusser, who suggested somehow to use the term of the projectionist, the project, as an alternative to the subject. Which is quite a nice idea, but this is a different idea or concept of the project than this one, which is now inflationary everywhere. Everybody is talking about a project. You wake up in the morning and you are doing a project. We are used to that here at the art universities, and then it turns out that you are just perhaps getting a cup of coffee, and this is the project of the day. André Ucsika, please.
Thank you, Hans, very much for these wonderful lectures and talks. I have also a question. When you mean Western art and Gombrich, also in the meaning of Gombrich, he means, in fact, Christian art. Yeah, Western art is the art of Christianity. And what means this? Western art as a Christian art is the for two millennia, the successful oppression of mass culture. And what is Islamic art, from this point of view, is for 1,000, almost 400 years, the successful oppression of Christian art. When the beginning of the, more or less, when the beginning of the modernity from this perspective, as Weibel also mentioned, is come back to the to tradition, to tribal tradition before the monotheism and before the modern art come also to rediscovering of the popular and mass culture, then is the question also if art after art is not also art after God?
I would strongly reject the idea that modern art can be called a Christian art.
Western art.
That Western modern art can be called Christian. I think it's the opposite.
Okay. That's a long discussion.
Yeah, yeah. I don't mean the modern art. The traditional Western art from the beginning to the modernity. The classical Western art is a Christian art from the year 1000 to the end of the 19th century. Or not?
I think we should discuss. Peter, the last question, and then we have to look at the clock because we have another part of the program. Peter.
Hans, in the 60s, there was the question that was posed, what could be the art after the end of art? And the answer was the invention, for example, of anti-art. And the most important answer was to this question, which you posed again, expansion of art. Because when me and my colleague, media artists, did work, everybody said, this is not art. So we finally said, okay, if you use a photograph, a video, a film, and said, it's not art, so we just speak about words. We did not say anymore artworks, we said works. So we had the concept of expansion of the art and also the expansion of the concept of art. Do you think for the future this idea is still valid, or do you think we cannot go on forever in expanding the concept of art?
Thank you.
Tricky question.
Thank you. My last option, but it's the second part. We cannot go on forever expanding art because what we extend and extend maybe doesn't exist any longer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Hans, for this introduction. Thank you for the discussion. I'm sure that we come back to many of the questions which were asked tonight. We will now listen finally to Echo, and then I have a few but quite important final remarks. Please, Echo, take the stage.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Echo, and I hope that you will visit us again and fill this wonderful space with your poetry and your sounds. Thanks a lot. The evening is not finished yet. I have the great pleasure to announce that our professor for the moving image, Jawa Tabarra from Portugal, is opening an exhibition especially for you, for all the guests, with the work of his students tonight. This is in the back part of the hall here. You can see already some of the images there. Thanks to Jawa and all the students who are taking part, because they really worked hard over the last days and nights to make this small presentation possible. They take as a starting point, you can read it there, this is not an exhibition, it's a presentation of work in progress. Enjoy it, discuss with the students. All the participants and of course the colleagues are invited now for a supper here on the railing on the first floor. You just go up the staircase and the supper is waiting for us and for you. Tomorrow morning we will start at 10 o'clock, quite punctual, in one of the exhibitions of the ZKM, Frei Otto, Thinking in Models. Peter will be there and will talk about the exhibition and the concept behind it a little bit with you, and we have the possibility to go through the arts, so to speak, into our discussion tomorrow morning. First, and not last tonight, I have to thank a few people who are extremely important for making possible what we are doing here and what we will do for the next days. Of course, Daniel Irgang and Ali Garib, you had many communications with him via email, already via internet. They were not only co-organizing the whole thing, but especially Daniel Irgang is part of the concept thinking, and I'm very grateful to them. Without them, the work definitely would not exist that we have tried to create. Very important also for tonight and for the next evenings, Sebastian Schäfer and Alexander Knoppik, who are running the studio, our studio boys, as they call themselves, and Felix Plachczyk and Manuel Kisto for different kinds of technical support and help. They did a great job for the last days and they will continue to help us. Isabel Koch, who did the public relations and all the press work around the conference. Of course, Monika Thalmann, I think she's not here anymore, who helped us a lot in organizing quite a few things. And last but not least, we had two wonderful designers who created the visual identity for the conference. I must find their names. Yes, this is Katrin Rüll and Janos Bela Kratz. They did the posters and all the programs and the internet design. Thanks a lot to all of them. Definitely I have forgotten a few, but I will not speak the last time tonight. It's the beginning of our conference. I thank again very much Hans Belting for this wonderful talk and the many questions we are taking now into our discussions. Thanks to Peter Weibel, to Echo Ho again, and everybody who helped us to make this start. I wish you a wonderful evening, and I hope to see you upstairs for a late supper and a drink. See you tomorrow morning at 10. We will start quite punctually. We are in Germany. Thank you very much.